So the minimum wage debate continues on, as Seattle plans to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. If passed, it'll be the highest minimum wage in the U.S. So they'll bump it right up to $15 an hour, and everyone will get paid more, and workers in Seattle will all be better off. Right? Here's the thing. They're not doing that. The plan is to bump it up a little at a time, finally getting it to $15 an hour in 2021. And even then, there are so many exceptions and loopholes, no one can make heads or tails of it. Meanwhile, voters in Switzerland overwhelmingly rejected a minimum wage close to $25 an hour. 76% voted against it, with only 24% supporting it. If it had passed, it would have been Switzerland's first minimum wage ever. If people who have never had minimum wage voted down overwhelmingly, it tells you something. When they look around, they don't see the horrible scenarios supporters like to fearmonger about. They know it isn't true. The Swiss aren't working for 10 cents an hour. In fact, in Switzerland, the median household income is about $47,000, more than it is in the U.S. That in itself should tell you something. Still, the supporters of minimum wage, like the moon hoaxers and the chemtrail nuts, continue unabated, not letting little things like empiricism and economic theory get in the way of their delusion. So they cite study after study, which attempt to debunk the consensus among labor economists that minimum wages destroy jobs and disproportionately hurt the working poor and minorities, the very people they're supposed to help. Pretty much all of these studies go the same way. Small increases in the minimum wage have no negative employment effects. In other words, if we raise the minimum wage just a little, there won't be any additional unemployment. Here's the first problem. As has been well established before, the burden of proof is on the side that wants to use force. As Matt Dillahunty said,
"You do not wait until you have an evidence that something is okay to do before you permit it. Instead, you permit things until you have good reason to think that you should not permit them."
Right.
So no, simply saying there are no bad effects is not enough. You do not get to win by default. We don't have to prove that minimum wage is harmful, even though we can. You have to prove not just that it's not harmful, but that there's a benefit, and that this benefit justifies the use of force against peaceful people in not permitting them to engage in voluntary exchanges just because you don't think that one side benefits enough from it. The burden of proof is on you. That's how it works. And this whole, "you can't prove it's harmful," just doesn't cut it. But that's pretty much all the pro-minimum wage side has. Take this article in Slate.com from two-time idiot extraordinaire Matthew Iglesias called "The Research Case for a Higher Minimum Wage." He references a study called "Minimum Wage Effects Across State Borders, Estimates Using Contiguous Counties," and says, quote, "The finding is that there's zero employment impact within the actually occurring range of variation. This does not rule out, obviously, that a $50 minimum wage would cause job losses." Now keep in mind, this is the case for minimum wage. This is the best evidence he can find. He references another paper, "Do Minimum Wages Really Reduce Teen Employment?" which concludes, quote, "The employment and hours elasticities are indistinguishable from zero and rules out any but very small disemployment effects." Again, small increases result in small effects, and the effect is indistinguishable from zero. But even then, right in the paper, they acknowledge that there still could be, quote, "very small disemployment effects." My guess is they had to put that in to get it to pass peer review. But it makes the point. This is not evidence that minimum wage is not harmful. Anyone who has any experience whatsoever with scientific studies will immediately see the problem here. If you're measuring the effect of something, a small amount of the something will give you a small effect, whatever it is. And when the amount of something gets small enough, the effect size gets smaller than the margin of error for the study. In other words, it gets lost in the statistical noise. That is what indistinguishable from zero means, although phrasing it that way is very misleading. None of these studies can show zero negative employment effects. That's impossible. All they can show is that whatever effect there might be is too small to be statistically significant given the methodology of the study. That is not the same as the effect not being there at all. Just because a result is statistically insignificant doesn't mean it's not there and doesn't mean it's not harmful. It means only that it can't be accurately measured using that study's methodology. A different study with better controls, a larger sample size, or a more thorough regression analysis could end up measuring the effect, an effect that is very real for millions of people. The word insignificant applies only to the statistics. It does not mean it doesn't matter to actual people in the real world. One point to keep in mind is that only about 3% of U.S. workers make minimum wage. The rest make more. First off, this stands as an absolute refutation of the statist claim. They pretend that with no minimum wage, we'd all be working for 10 cents an hour or something. Clearly, this is bogus. But the real point here is that, with so few people working for minimum wage, in order to get a better measure of the employment effects of raising the minimum wage, you need to focus on target groups. Since if you look at the entire labor force, the fact that so few people are working for so little money means you're pushing the results even further down into statistical insignificance. Iglesias does a lot of wild speculation as to what might really be going on, but the data, the totality of the data, not just a few cherry-picked studies, shows the only rational conclusion we can draw. Two of the world's most prominent labor economists and minimum wage researchers, David Newmark, professor of economics at the University of California at Irvine and research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research and the Institute for the Study of Labor, and William Washer, deputy director of the Federal Reserve Board of Governors, examined 100 prominent minimum wage studies made since 1990. They concluded, quote, "We see very few, if any, studies that provide convincing evidence of positive employment effects of minimum wages, especially from those studies that focus on the broader groups rather than a narrow industry for which the competitive model generally predicts disemployment effects. Second, the studies that focus on the least skilled groups that are likely most directly affected by minimum wage increases provide relatively overwhelming evidence of stronger disemployment effects for these groups." Now, there are a lot of lies being told by statists about this study, so let me take a minute to go into it in more detail. They began with the studies included in Cornell University's Industrial and Labor Relations Review Symposium. Some of these studies are from Newmark and Washer themselves. Despite what statist liars will tell you, there is nothing wrong with this. Saying there is like saying that Albert Einstein couldn't reference his own work on relativity in later papers. Clear bogosity. It does not make this study biased. Unless you want to show that the ILR review is biased as well, good luck with that. They also added to that data from around the world in both developed and developing nations. And after sifting through all the data, they concluded, quote, "The oft-stated assertion that the new minimum wage research fails to support the conclusion that the minimum wage reduces the employment of low-skilled workers is clearly incorrect. Indeed, in our view, the preponderance of the evidence points to disemployment effects." For example, the studies surveyed in this monograph correspond to 102 entries in our summary tables. Of these, nearly two-thirds give a relatively consistent, although by no means always statistically significant, indication of negative employment effects of minimum wages, while only 8 give a relatively consistent indication of positive employment effects. In addition, we have highlighted in the tables 33 studies or entries that we regard as providing the most credible evidence, and 28, 85%, of these point to negative employment effects. Moreover, when researchers focus on the least skilled groups most likely to be adversely affected by minimum wages, the evidence for disemployment effects seems especially strong. In contrast, we see very few, if any, cases where a study provides convincing evidence of positive employment effects of minimum wages, especially among the studies that focus on broader groups for which the competitive model predicts disemployment effects. So the studies on the minimum wage can pretty much be divided into two categories. One which examined a large enough minimum wage increase to have a significant effect, and ones where the increase was so small, or the group studied so wide, that any effect was not statistically significant. Any scientist worth his salt will tell you what to do in such a case. You ignore the studies with insignificant results and look only at the studies where the effect was large enough to show up among the statistical noise. Then, to find out what the real effects of smaller increases are, you plot a linear regression based on the data that are statistically significant and extrapolate it back to see the smaller effects. This is precisely what they do with the adverse health benefits of many toxic substances. To find out what the health effects of ingesting small amounts of the toxin in question would be, in a case where studying those small amounts would yield results that are not statistically significant, they look at larger effects in the range where it can be measured and extrapolate backwards, using the linear regression to estimate what the smaller effects would be of smaller doses. And when you do that with minimum wage, you find that the measured effects converge on a linear trend. A 10% increase in the minimum wage will reduce employment in vulnerable groups, such as teenagers, by 1% and overall by 0.04%. That may not sound like much, but remember, we're only talking about a 10% increase, and people are talking about raising it much more than that. We're also talking about this as additional unemployment on top of the workers who have already been priced out of the market by previous minimum wages. If the minimum wage proponents really believed what they'd say, they'd do this. Look at the studies with large enough effects to measure and extrapolate backwards to smaller increases. But they don't. If this happened in any other scientific field, these proponents would be laughingstocks. But it's economics, so I guess it's not real science, so whatever supports what government wants to do must be right. So the next time some pro-minimum wage statist tries to throw these studies in your face, ask them why they're only looking at the effects of increases too small to show up among the statistical noise. And that's why Seattle's not raising the minimum wage to $15 an hour right away. If they did, the folly of the minimum wage would be obvious, but by doing it in small steps, the negative employment effects get overwhelmed by other factors in the economy, so they're not visible. But that doesn't mean they're not there. They clearly are. Folks, this is another example of belief in belief. If they really believed minimum wage was good, they'd have no problem increasing it to $15 an hour right away. The fact that they don't, and they only push it up a little at a time so it won't be obvious what's going on, shows that they know they're destroying jobs, and they don't care. They may tell themselves they do, but that's just belief in belief. In their mental model of the universe, everything will work out exactly as it would if minimum wage destroyed jobs, and the smaller increases simply spread it out enough that it gets lost in the noise. Don't fall for it.